On Tuesday this week, we'll be continuing our Tuesday study at 6 p.m. British Summer Time via Zoom. We're continuing to explore and to discuss the Methodist way of life, so please join us if you can. If you haven't yet done so, why not join us for Tuesday fast? It's very simple. You give up breakfast and lunch on a Tuesday so that by the time you come to your evening meal on a Tuesday, it's roughly 24 hours or so since your last meal. In the time that you're not preparing or eating your lunch or breakfast, you have some additional time to pray and to be open to God. So join us this Tuesday for Tuesday fast. In the description of this video below, you'll find a link to our PayPal giving page. If you're not already supporting our work through one of our local churches, but you'd like to do so, you'll find an easy link below to help you give. If you haven't yet subscribed to this channel, please take a moment to do so. If you click on the notifications button, you'll ensure that you're the first to hear of any new content uploaded to the channel, including new songs that will feature in our worship. Please also like this video if it's a blessing to you. Liking and subscribing are used by YouTube algorithms to make this video easier to find by others. So by liking and subscribing, we'll be helping to share something of our faith.
Good morning and welcome to Covenant Community Online Sunday Worship. I'm Calvin Samuel, Methodist minister for the Essex towns of Huckley, Rochford and Raleigh on the edge of Southend. In Matthew's genealogy of Jesus, four women are mentioned in addition to Mary, the mother of Jesus: Tamar, Rahab, Ruth and Bathsheba. In preparation for Bible Month in July, when we'll be looking at the story of Ruth, we're spending the month of June encountering the stories of four extraordinary women connected with Ruth. Last week, we began with the story of Leah, who is not mentioned in Matthew's genealogy, but whose story is deeply interwoven with each of the five women named. She's the grandmother of Tamar's children and the ancestor of the husbands of Rahab, Ruth, Bathsheba, and Mary. This week, we come to the story of Tamar. It's not a story for the faint-hearted, I'm afraid. Tamar is a woman who experienced loss, bereavement, betrayal, misogyny, injustice, and was at one point on the verge of being burnt at the stake. Despite all this, Tamar survived. She became mother to one of the greatest tribes of Israel, the tribe of Judah, from whom its kings descended. Without Tamar, we'd never have got to David, Solomon, or even Jesus. Tamar is described by Judah as righteous. I'm grateful to my friend and former colleague Anne Clements, whose book Mothers on the Margins is a resource for this sermon series. Anne is a Baptist minister, and her PhD research on the women in the genealogy of Matthew was later published as Mothers on the Margins. And if this sermon series piques your interest, go find the book. It's extraordinarily helpful. And I'm delighted today that my wife Ramona has agreed to be our preacher. And she will unpack for us a little later in the service something of the story of Tamar the righteous. Our first hymn speaks of waiting for God as Tamar did, seeking God's vindication. If you know it, please do sing along at home.
I'm falling on my
As we come to our prayers, I invite you to respond using the words in yellow which appear on screen, or the text in bold type if you're listening on audio and working from a hard copy. Let us pray. Your glory, O God, fills heaven and earth, and all creation resounds with your praise. As we rejoice in your presence, may we know your power to save, and praise you for your faithfulness now and forever. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Let's confess our sins to God. If we have fallen into despair, Lord, forgive us. If we have failed to hope in you, Lord, forgive us. If we have been fearful of death, Lord, forgive us. If we have forgotten the victory of Christ, Lord, forgive us. In silence, bring your own confessions before the Lord. May the living God raise us from despair. Give us victory over sin, and set us free in Christ. Amen. Our scripture readings today come from the book of Genesis, chapter 38, beginning from verse 1. And our reader is Janet from our early congregation.
At that time, Judah left his brothers and went down to stay with a man of Adullam named Hirah. There Judah met the daughter of a Canaanite man named Shua. He married her and lay with her. She became pregnant and gave birth to a son, who was named Ur. She conceived again and gave birth to a son and named him Onan. She gave birth to still another son and named him Shelah. It was at Kezib that she gave birth to him. Judah got a wife for Ur, his firstborn, and her name was Tamar. But Ur, Judah's firstborn, was wicked in the Lord's sight, so the Lord put him to death. Then Judah said to Onan, "Lie with your brother's wife and fulfill your duty to her as a brother-in-law, to produce offspring for your brother." But Onan knew that the offspring would not be his, so whenever he lay with his brother's wife, he spilled his semen on the ground to keep from producing offspring for his brother. What he did was wicked in the Lord's sight, so he put him to death. Judah then said to his daughter-in-law Tamar, "Live as a widow in your father's house until my son Shelah grows up," for he thought he might die too, just like his brothers. So Tamar went to live in her father's house. After a long time, Judah's wife, the daughter of Shelah, died. When Judah had recovered from his grief, he went up to Timnah, to the men who were shearing his sheep, and his friend Hirah, the Adullamite, went with him. When Tamar was told, "Your father-in-law is on his way to Timnah to shear his sheep," she took off her widow's clothes, covered herself with a veil to disguise herself, and then sat down at the entrance to Enaim, which is on the road to Timnah. For she saw that although Shelah had now grown up, she had not been given to him as his wife. When Judah saw her, he thought she was a prostitute, for she had covered her face. Not realizing that she was his daughter-in-law, he went over to her by the roadside and said, "Come now, let me sleep with you." "And what will you give me to sleep with you?" she said. "I'll send you a young goat from my flock," he said. "Will you give me something as a pledge until you send it?" she asked. He said, "What pledge should I give you?" "Your seal and its cord and the staff in your hand," she answered. So he gave them to her and slept with her, and she became pregnant by him. After she left, she took off her veil and put on her widow's clothes again. Meanwhile, Judah sent the young goat by his friend the Adullamite in order to get his pledge back from the woman, but he did not find her. He asked the men who lived there, "Where is the shrine prostitute who was beside the road at Enaim?" "There hasn't been any shrine prostitute here," they said. So he went back to Judah and said, "I didn't find her. Besides, the men who lived there said there hasn't been any prostitutes here." Then Judah said, "Let her keep what she has, or we will become a laughingstock. After all, I did send her this young goat, but you didn't find her." About 3 months later, Judah was told, "Your daughter-in-law Tamar is guilty of prostitution, and as a result, she is now pregnant." Judah said, "Bring her out and have her burnt to death." As she was being brought out, she sent a message to her father-in-law. "I am pregnant by the man who owns these," she said. And she added, "See if you recognize whose seal and cord and staff these are." Judah recognized them and said, "She is more righteous than I, since I wouldn't give her to my son Shelah." And he did not sleep with her again. When the time came for her to give birth, there were twin boys in her womb. As she was giving birth, one of them put out his hand. So the midwife took a scarlet thread and tied it on his wrist and said, "This one came out first." But when he drew back his hand and his brother came out, and she said, "So this is how you've broken out." And he was named Perez. Then his brother, who had the scarlet thread on his wrist, came out, and he was given the name Zerah. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Abide with me, fast falls the eventide. The darkness deepens, Lord, with me abide. When other helper fail and comforts flee, help of the helpless, oh, abide with me.
Today. So let's pray for Ramona now as she comes to share with us God's word. Loving God, thank you for Ramona, for her work and ministry. We pray for her as she opens up the story of Tamar the righteous to us. We pray that by your Spirit you would open our hearts to your word so that you may change us and inspire us in the name of Christ.
The story of Tamar is one that, if we're honest, most of us would skip over because it makes for very uncomfortable reading and cannot be explained easily. That Tamar appears in Matthew's genealogy of Jesus might be a mystery to some, but Clements, in her book Mothers on the Margin, argues that it resonates with Matthew's gospel on three levels. First, a reversal of expectation, when we find an outsider is shown to respond in more appropriate ways in the aspects of faith. Two, it highlights the contribution of someone who is structurally and culturally marginalized. And three, it brings to the foreground the role of women in the purposes of God. If we read through Matthew's gospel, we see those three areas clearly through the ways in which Jesus interacted with those around him. But what of Tamar? What can we learn from such a complicated and difficult story? I want to suggest that we learn from Tamar the cost of justice seeking, as well as what righteousness looks like from a disadvantaged viewpoint. But first, let's take a brief look at what actually happened. Tamar's story begins with Judah's story in Genesis 38, which is quite fitting considering the ending. We are told that Judah marries, has three sons, the eldest one being Er, the husband of Tamar. We are not given details about Er's behavior, apart from being told that he was wicked. So God took his life. We won't go into whether it was Er's wickedness that caused his death, as in he might have been doing something dodgy, or did God actually kill him? But perhaps you might want to discuss this with others at some point later. However, let's continue with Tamar's story. According to the laws at the time, when a husband dies without leaving an heir, his widow was given to his closest of kin, and in this case, Er's brother Onan, so that an heir could be birthed and the husband's line continue. This was known as levirate marriage and was a common practice in societies where there was a strong clan culture. But that was also a way of protecting the woman, because then a woman belonged first to her father and then to her husband. Furthermore, the woman could not inherit anything following her husband's death, and therefore having children, particularly having a son, was a way in which she could be taken care of. It is significant for us to note here that the early church was admonished to look after widows. So as a society, then and now, we have a duty of care. And we see that in 1 Timothy 5, verse 3 to 4. So let's continue with the story. Unfortunately, Onan, Er's brother, who was given to Tamar, did not like the arrangement because he did not want to father his brother's heir. And despite going along with the benefits of having a wife, did the unthinkable. He spilled his seed, which meant that Tamar could not and did not get pregnant. Again, we are told that God intervenes because of this wickedness that Onan did, and Judah loses his second son. At this point, Judah's third son, Shelah, is not old enough to be married. So Tamar is sent back to her father's household with the promise from Judah that she would be wedded to Shelah when he became of age. But Judah had no intention of following up on that promise. Are you keeping up so far? This is quite a lot. This surely is one of those soap storylines akin to EastEnders or the American soap opera, The Bold and the Beautiful. So anyway, eventually, Judah's wife dies, and after the mourning period, he travels to Timnah, and Tamar hears of this, which brings us to what happens next. Tamar, by then, realizes that Judah had no intention of giving Shelah, even though he had come of age, and so she puts into action a plan of her own to safeguard her future. I mentioned earlier that we would look at justice seeking and righteousness in the context of being a disadvantaged person or people, and here we have it. Because of the way in which Tamar has been handled, lied to, put to a disadvantage, she herself devised a plan out of sheer desperation and a desire to survive in a society that disregarded her as a widow, a childless one at that. And here we have a situation where she disguises herself as a prostitute and waits for Judah. And sure enough, she gets him to acknowledge her. But this acknowledgement is not what Tamar would have preferred. She would have much rather Judah kept his promise and given her Shelah and do the right thing. But she felt she was left with no other alternative that would be beneficial to her. And this is what I mean by justice seeking from a place of disadvantage. We see that in society today, where people on the margins, weighted down by poverty, resort to drastic measures in order to safeguard their well-being. How many of us can forget the image of the refugee child being carried out of the sea following the dreadful plight as his family attempted to seek a better life? How many of us have commented in disgust at people we consider to be benefits croungers, or the person living on the street who resorts to drugs or alcohol? Now, I'm not condemning the use of drugs or alcohol abuse. What I am saying is that, like Judah, our systems and sometimes we ourselves have contributed in part to the demise of some members of our society. Who are the Tamars that we are forcing into taking risky chances just so they could make a life for themselves? Sure, Tamar, in a sense, you could call it that, tricked Judah. But Clement points to another book written by Nidditch, which is a prelude to biblical folklore, in which the writer likens this trickery as a form of wisdom. And Clement also quotes Prowser in the book, Truth About Women, who argues that deception is a justifiable weapon to enable disadvantaged and less powerful people to gain justice. Now, that's quite a powerful statement. Deception is a justifiable weapon to enable disadvantaged and less powerful people to gain justice. And I'm sure if we look through history, we can most certainly find examples of this. So what happens next? Well, sure enough, Tamar gets pregnant. Judah hears of this and is outraged, and he orders that she be burned, because that's what happened. Because after all, a widow becoming pregnant meant that this happened through unscrupulous means. And in Tamar's society, this type of behavior was more than frowned upon. It was unacceptable and had severe consequences: death. It is interesting to read Judah's response to Tamar prostituting herself when he himself showed no such morality or concern when he approached who he thought was a prostitute. But that's how we are as human beings, quick to point out what others are doing wrong, yet not so quick to deal with our own flaws and wrongdoings. From here on, the story gets more interesting because Tamar had prepared for such an eventuality. And she'd asked for proof from Judah that he would give her the goat as payment, which was promised when they made the deal. It is at this point that Judah takes responsibility, because Tamar had proof that he indeed was the one who had fathered this child with which she was pregnant. And so he takes responsibility not only for his actions of sleeping with a prostitute, but his unwillingness and avoidance in doing what the law required by giving his third son to Tamar. And so, in an interesting twist worthy of a Hollywood film, Judah points to the righteousness of Tamar. So what are we to make of this righteousness as mentioned in the text? Now, Clemens considers being righteous as behaving in a way that is appropriate to others in fulfilling requirements and obligations of a particular relationship. In other words, we are righteous within the framework of the relationships we find ourselves in. We cannot be righteous in isolation. We do that in community with those that we are linked with. And in that respect, Judah proved to be unrighteous because he did not fulfill his obligations to Tamar. While Tamar is seen as righteous or as acting rightly because she made choices not solely for her benefit, but in honor of her deceased husband to continue his genetic line. As social beings, righteousness is imperative if we are to live in harmony with each other and according to God's standards. It is within this context of trickery and desperate behavior that we find the lineage of Jesus, spearheaded by strong women placed in almost impossible situations that cause them to take extreme risk to procure the livelihood of future generations. It is no wonder that throughout the Gospels, we see Jesus befriending the marginalized and embracing the women as rightful heirs of the kingdom. Jesus himself is the embodiment of the justice seeking and righteousness we see exemplified by Tamar, and we would do well to learn from both. And so, over to us. Where are the places and situations that may require us to act in wisdom trickery so that justice can be gained and righteousness fulfilled? I want to suggest that those situations and events might be closer to us than we may think. Amen.
God of justice, Savior to all, came to rescue the weak and the poor, chose to serve and not be served. Jesus, you have called. us up, send us out. Fill us up, send us out. Fill us up, send us out, Lord. Send us out, fill us up, do it, Jesus. Lord, in tenderness, love and mercy, we must go to the broken and the hurting, we must go. Inside the broken, we must go, stepping forward, keep us from just seeing, move us into action, we must go. We must go.
Thanks to Ramona for leading us in our sermon today. As we come to our prayers of intercession, if you're watching this live with me here on YouTube, you can add your own prayers of intercession into the chat section. If you're catching this later on, you can add some prayers in the comment section below. And of course, if you're joining us on audio, please, please do add your own prayers as we go. So let's pray. Remember, O Lord, in your love, the Church throughout the world, those recently baptized or confirmed, and those whose baptism or confirmation has been delayed because of the pandemic. We pray also for all who minister to others. May your whole Church know your power and be a sign that Christ is risen, Lord of life. Hear us. In your love. Remember in your love the world that you have made. We pray for those who seek a fair and proper use of the world's resources, all who strive for justice and peace among the nations. May the whole earth be transformed by mercy and rejoice in hope. Lord of life, hear us in your love. Remember in your love those who, like Tamar, suffer as victims of violence and injustice, and all who mourn today. May all in need find comfort, strength, and freedom in the living Christ. Give us wisdom and courage to challenge systemic injustice wherever we encounter it, and work towards a better future. Lord of life, hear us. In your love. Remember in your love those who have died, those who have confessed the faith, and those whose faith is known to you alone. And may all your children receive grace and light according to their needs and come at last to share with all the saints in life eternal. Lord of life, hear us in your love. God of salvation, you sent your Son to seek out and save what is lost. Hear our prayers on behalf of those who are lost in our day. Receiving these petitions and thanksgivings with your unending compassion. Amen. In silence, let's commend ourselves and all for whom we pray to the mercy and protection of God. We draw all our prayers together. in the prayer that Jesus gave us in its modern form. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Tamar was a woman of courage and boldness. Tamar took a risk which, if it had gone badly, could have resulted in her being put to death. When justice was withheld from her, she waited for years, until a moment presented itself when she could get from her nearest kinsman, Judah, what had been withheld from her. Sometimes it's those closest to us, and who should be looking out for us, who let us down most badly. Our final hymn is a reminder that even when our friends and loved ones are nowhere to be found, our lives are in the hands of God. And if that's true, no matter how bad things get, no matter how bad things look, there's no need to worry. Brooklyn Tabernacle Choir sings our final hymn, "My Life is in Your Hands." Please, please do sing along.
Tears.
much for joining me for today's service as we have come to the second of our four extraordinary women that we'll be looking at in the month of June. Next week, we'll be looking at Rahab. But now for our blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with kindness and give you peace. Amen.
I will come.
We're telling you, call on him.